Welcome to this journey where we dialogue with thought and heart leaders to share their reflections on human condition and how to improve them. Today we have with us Chade Meng Tan. Chade, popularly known as Jolly Good Fellow at Google, has been searching and penning down his mission for world peace. His first book, Search Inside Yourself, was New York Times bestseller. And his new book, Joy on Demand, further nuances the practices for a more joyful living.
Meng, you came up with this wonderful book recently called Joy on Demand. And yes. It came and it followed the earlier bestseller, the New York Times bestseller, Search Inside Yourself. So what really inspired you to come up with this book? If you can share some of the insights around that.
The original inspiration for writing Joy on Demand was to help people to meditate, rather to sustain the practice. So what happened was this. I wrote Search Inside Yourself, and I taught a class and so on. And I keep having people coming to tell me, you know, random people I just met on the lift and say, oh, it's you, you changed my life, right? Which I said, good, good. And then I was like, good. And you read my book, you say, yeah. I said, how's your practice? I'm not doing it anymore. So, and I discovered something. I discovered that a lot of people, they learn, they read my book, they took my class, and then they say, I want to do this. And then their meditation practice went up, and then, shoo. And it's not surprising. You're not surprised. So it turns out none of the meditation teachers I know are surprised, right? And then it turns out that even in like the gym, they have the same problem.
Yes.
Right? So yes. They go to the gym. People say, "Hey, I want to do this for the rest of my life. Now I'm so healthy." And then 8 weeks later, they stop going to the gym.
Yes.
So I started wondering to myself, right? How can I help all these people sustain their practice? And I figured that there are a couple of ways. So based on the gym experience, one way is basically mutual harassment. a gym buddies, I mean. Right. So your buddy, you go to the gym together, or you take a class, you're committed to class. If you don't go, you get harassed, right? So
yes.
That forces you to go. So that's one. So have a buddy. That's a community, rather, which is why we have Sangha, right, community.
Yes.
Unfortunately, in where I live in the US, there is no Sangha per se. So there's a second way, which is using joy, right? So in physical exercise, the way to do that is you gamify exercise. You turn exercise into a sport and into a game, and it's called sport, right? So
yes.
People play sport, and when they play sport, but they get healthy. So I started thinking, how do I help people like feel joyful doing this practice, right?
Yeah.
And so the complication is that exercise is stimulus-led, a lot of stimulus, but meditation is stimulus-free. So that's the complication. However, there is good news. The good news is that every meditator, and I think Heyman probably you as well, every meditator, when they reach a certain maturity in their practice, they reach a point where sitting alone is joyful.
Yes.
Just sitting is joyful.
Yes.
It's called a joy point. I call it a joy point. Once you're there, the teacher stops worrying about you because your practice is self-sustaining.
Yeah.
So the question I ask myself is, how do I help accelerate my students to the joy point? And I thought about it for months, and I realized that I've been asking myself the wrong question. The question I should be asking is, how do I front load joy in the process so that from day one, their sitting is joyful?
They
have a sustained practice.
Yeah.
So I started writing the book about how to do that. And then, once you went to the publisher, my editor looked at it and said, you know what, if you just change it by 10%, you can turn it into a general book on joy for everybody.
Wow.
So I did that. I just moved a few things here and there. I rewrote the introduction, and then there's a general joy book. So that's it.
As you're narrating this, I'm reminded of some of the work that is happening in behavioral science, where the whole idea is gentle nudge, you know, tiny habits, gentle nudge. So would that be a good, would that be a good thing to say that your practices are in alignment with those concepts?
Yes, yes, and it's something deeper. So for a while, I thought that practice was about managing, I mean, sustaining practice. I thought it was about managing energy, right? You need the energy to practice. And then I realized I was wrong. And then I thought maybe it's about managing joy. And then I thought even that was wrong. I think essentially it's about managing interest. If it's something you're interested in, then you have the energy and the joy. So it's all about managing interest. And so as part of managing interest are things we talk about, gentle nudges, right? Forming habits, finding joy in the process, and so on and so forth. But it's essentially about managing joy, interest.
Managing interest, yeah. That's interesting. That's interesting.
Oh, this thing called interest. Them rising from passion and reasons serving. Are you talking about that? Or them of another kind, where all seems interesting, where reason and passion dance together, where boredoms I yearn. Does it contain me, or I contain it? Oh, this thing called interest.
When people start practicing this, and they have this leaning, this inclination, and they keep practicing more, and as you've been rightly pointing out, that it keeps growing on you. You know, the more you practice, it grows on you. Would this change people's relation with things outside of them that they consume or they use in their lives?
Oh yeah, most definitely.
Okay.
Yes. So first, there's something very important that we need to acknowledge. And I think you from India probably you're more aware than I am. But I grew up in Singapore. So I grew up in Singapore when it was a third world country. So I have some awareness as well. And which is described, which is that poverty is a source of suffering. This is very important to recognize.
Yes.
So therefore, and one of the implications of that, poverty is a source of suffering. One implication is, it's our responsibility, all of us as human beings, to help everybody be out of poverty. So
yes.
Having said that, right, but once you go from poor to not poor, that's when things change. So if you're poor, more material things makes a huge difference. But if you go from poor to not poor, from the time you're not poor onwards, having more material things doesn't make you happier.
Yes.
And a lot of people they don't get this. So a lot of people they just keep consuming stuff. I mean, people who are not poor, we get consuming stuff, hoping to be happier, but it doesn't work. So part of mindfulness practice, there are two or three pieces. One piece is this recognition, right? Because when you see your life moment to moment in mindfulness, you realize that more stuff doesn't need to happen. So that's the insight. The second thing is, just, I think even more important, is that what we talked about earlier, the ability, I mean, the learning that the ability to just sit brings joy. Like nothing happens. I just sit here and joyful. And that means what? That means that I don't have to consume stuff. That joy is independent of material needs. I mean, material beyond survival. Once I can survive, joy is beyond material, having more material wealth. And therefore, the combination of these two leads people to, how should I say it, to not be caught into the consumerism craze.
Can we also import from this explanation that on one side, when it helps developing more joy or having more joy independent of material, can we also say that when we start consuming material, we start savoring them more, and hence the consumption is slightly different? Could that be said?
Oh, yes, definitely. At least that's my experience. Right.
Okay.
So and at least my experience is one of my practices is which I wrote about in the book is noticing thin slices of joy. right? And the thin slice of joy is as simple as, hey, so now I've been talking for, I don't know, 10 minutes, I've been thirsty, I drink water. That was joyful, right? Very thin slice. It lasted for 2 or 3 seconds, and it was like, it wasn't like, yeah, it was like, right? And when I start noticing this, I realized that this thin slice of joy is everywhere in life. Right, and that does a few things for me. The first thing it does is I start appreciating my life a lot more. The second thing it does is, as you said, the same consumption now gives me more joy. And the third thing it does is gratefulness, gratitude. I start to be grateful for what I have.
Interesting.
So all these things are good for happiness.
I ask for a moment's indulgence to sit by thy side. The works that I have in hand, I will finish afterwards. Away from the sight of thy face, my heart knows no rest nor respite, and my work becomes an endless toil in a shoreless sea of toil. Today, the summer has come at my window with its sighs and murmurs, and the bees are plying their minstrelsy at the court of the flowering grove. Now it is time to sit quiet, face to face with thee, and to sing dedication of life in this silent and overflowing leisure.
There's one more concern that is growing nowadays that we see in India right now, is suddenly in the last 10 to 15 years, we see a lot of scientific evidences now backing ancient wisdom. And I think that is something that is a subject that interests you a lot, where the blend of ancient wisdom with modern science. But then at the same time, you have counterfactual evidences also coming. So case in point would be on one side, you have somebody championing empathy, gratitude, and the other side, you would have a researcher negating it. And the audience sort of seems to be confused as to what should they be doing. In these confused states, how would you encourage audiences or people to take up these practices? There are researches coming from some university where they say empathy can drain you out.
Yes.
And then on the other side, we have researches coming in terms of empathy being our natural state, and that's something that is there. But as we progress in the society, we develop layers of being more rational.
I understand. So the solution to that problem is deeper wisdom, and that wisdom comes from a deep meditation practice. So you want your practice to be deep enough, and you get enough wisdom that you can hold both those opposing points of view at once.
Today.
And be able to understand the nuances. So, for example, what you just mentioned. For example, on one side, it says empathy is good, it's part of your natural being, and it's good for you and the society. The other part is saying empathy is bad, it drains you out, it makes you inefficient. Who is right? They are both right. Right? And so, once first, you have the wisdom to see how they're both right. And then, by seeing that, you also see the solution. So, the solution here is this. If you go deeper, you find that the solution coming from deeper wisdom is compassion. So if you have compassion, if you only have empathy alone, without compassion, what that does is this. Empathy is a physiological response. So when I empathize with you, your biological science becomes my biological science. So your pain becomes my pain. So all I feel is pain, and that is draining. However, if I also have loving kindness, metta, and compassion, karuna. If I have loving kindness and compassion, at the same time I'm holding your pain, I generate this kindness towards you and compassion. And in doing that, I generate joy. And according to the masters, my practice is not that good, but according to my masters, Matthew Ricard, for example, he said the ability to do this, it turns compassion into an infinite resource. You can do this for indefinitely.
Amazing.
So therefore, you find that, again, with wisdom, you find that once you apply, so they're both right about empathy, but once you apply kindness and compassion, then you can have empathy and have only the good sides and not the bad sides.
We also see the corporate sector, which is growing by the day, and the other term for corporate that we generally think of is scale, growth. And we also have researchers coming from organizations where the disengagement levels of employees in the organizations are fast increasing. And I think one of the reasons why this would be happening is employees not having sense of meaning from what they do and sense of gratitude towards what they're doing. Do you think joy on demand can help, practices around joy of demand can help people derive more meaning from their existing jobs?
I think so, but it's a bit more nuanced than that. There was one interesting case study that kind of blew my mind. And it happened near to where I live, actually, in the Bay Area, in Silicon Valley. There is a car factory in Fremont. And it was owned by, I think, GM, right? General Motors. And in the 80s, it was one of the worst car factories in the world. The low productivity, quality was bad, and worse than that, the workers were disengaged. They hated their job, they didn't care about the job, and some percentage of the workers are drunk while doing their job.
Okay.
Things were that bad. Things were so bad that GM closed down the plant because there's no way they can run it. And then Toyota bought it over. And this was in the 80s, right? And because of the contract, the labor contract, when Toyota bought it over, they, by law, they had to use the same workers. And then under Toyota, the plant became one of the most productive plants in the world.
Wow.
Same workers, right? From one of the worst to one of the best in like a year. Not even like over 10 years, but like a year. Like, what changed, right? So what changed was the way Toyota managed people versus the GM management. So one of the things they learned, for example, the GM workers, they learned something that blew their mind. So in GM, under GM, you never stop the line. Things go bad, people get sick, sometimes people die in accident. They don't care, just go on. In the Toyota case, there's a line overhead. Any worker can pull the line and stop all production.
Amazing.
So they see, yeah, and so what happened was, there's a true story, one screw was in the wrong place. A Toyota worker found one screw. He pulled the line, the entire thing stopped, fixed that one screw, and then continued. So, and then what the workers realized is that they have autonomy. So the first thing, their autonomy. Why they're autonomy? Because they're respected as a human being. And not just respected, and so they are building quality products. So they're pride in their work. And in pride, there's a certain sense of meaning. And that changed everything. So therefore, again, they say same workers, same plant, from worst to best in a year-ish. So what is the secret? The secret are things I just talked about. The treating of workers as human beings, respecting them, giving them the right autonomy and creativity and space to create, and so on. And all these things are inner factors. And therefore, I think my first book, Search Inside Yourself, is slightly more relevant because it does talk about inner motivation. It talks about empathy and compassion in management. So, and then the joy and demand is more of an inner joy component. So they both help, but my first book probably is more relevant to this.
My next question on this, or the next curiosity that I have on this is there a very strong correlation that you see between mindfulness and sustainability in times to come?
I definitely think so.
Okay.
Yeah, and the reason I think, I guess there's one reason, that the obvious one is consumption. But I think there's more than that. So the first consumption, right? Because once you practice mindfulness and shamatha, the calming of mind, you realize that, again, once you are no longer poor, you don't need much more. It's like, how much more can I eat? After a full meal, there's not much more to eat.
Yes.
How much better clothing can I wear? Right? Yes. I mean, the one I'm wearing now is $75 at Walmart. Right? How much better can this get? Right?
Yes.
So, consumption, that's one. But I think beyond consumption, something else happens, which is when you are in the practice of mindfulness and loving kindness, you also have a certain level of care. You care about people, you care about things, you care about the world. And so that changes things as well. And so therefore, the combination of these two will, I think, make a huge difference.
Hidden in this question is another curiosity that I have. So you find organizations driven by numbers with quarterly performance pressures. And when you're working in an organization in such a huge ship, let's say there is a shift in an individual through any of these practices, let's say joy on demand or any other such practices, but the organization's policies are still pushing towards high numbers and, you know, constant growth. Do you think there would be a dichotomy, a dilemma in an individual or a leader? Or do you think the person can still sustain this despite the story that is going on?
I don't know, but I have a very interesting case study.
Okay.
So let me give you the obvious answer, and then I come to this interesting case study. The obvious answer from if you read my book, you know what I'm going to say.
And with Meng, we know there is more.
the obvious answer are things I wrote about in my book, right? Like inner motivation, right? Autonomy, mastery, and meaning, right? And meaning and purpose, right? So if people work in something where they have these three things, they have autonomy, they have mastery. Mastery means they keep learning, they keep becoming better at something that they care about, and their purpose in their work, then they're self-motivated. Then you don't care about, and then the numbers take care of themselves, right? They will be motivated to achieve higher numbers. And of course, under that situation, you will also say, and this is what I'm going to achieve. And you're like, sure, I'm doing it anyway. So this is the obvious answer. There's a very interesting case study. This is from my friend who is a Zen monk. His name is Shoryu. And the first interesting thing about this Zen monk Shoryu is that he's a white guy from Vermont with blonde hair. It's very funny. I mean, his hair is shaven, but he's a blonde guy. So that alone is very funny. Right? And his practice is very, very deep. Just fascinating. So, and he looks really hard. The interesting thing, like most Zen monks, he's very hardworking. He works harder than me. So we were speaking in a company together, and then somebody asked him this question, the question you asked.
Okay.
And the answer he gave me blew my mind. So somebody asked him about work-life balance. And he stood there thinking for a very long time because he didn't really understand the question. I was like, so you really don't answer the question. and the way he put it is this. He says what he does, and I think what he says what he thinks everybody should do, is to work as hard as you can, but no harder.
Ah, okay.
Yeah, what does that mean? And he uses an analogy in physics, in exercise. See, when you exercise, what you should do is you work as hard as you can, but no harder.
Okay.
That is where you get maximum growth.
Interesting.
Right? Interesting. Yeah, and so you for himself, he works very hard, and he works as hard as he can, but no harder. And therefore, he can maximize all the goodness in life. Like he maximizes his autonomy, mastery, and purpose, and he does work that he's happy about, and he feels joy. And therefore, he did not experience the work-life balance issue. And therefore, he didn't understand the question.
Oh.
And so I haven't reached his level. But that led me to think, maybe, I don't really know what to think. But one of the partial answers I have is something we talked about earlier, which is the management of interest.
Yes, yes.
Yes. And just this morning, by the way, this is interesting, matter interesting. I had a conversation with Shoryu on this precise topic. And he told me something that, again, blew my mind. And he quoted somebody else. He quoted a master called Sun Zhen Yang. And they both agree. And they think that interest is a skill, right? That to be interested in something, to make yourself interested in anything, is a skill. And therefore, it's trainable.
Wow.
Yeah,
wow.
I know, that blew my mind. And they say one of the ways to train it is to choose an object that is not interesting and then learn to become interested in it, which is the breath. which is why people like you and I, my friend, like people who are deep meditators, also tend to be successful, because we know how to be interested in things that are important. And something that's important, like most of people say, I give up, I hate it, it sucks. But you and I, we can go, maybe I can make this interesting. And it's a skill that we have, but we didn't want to have it.
Amazing, amazing, amazing. Interestingly, there is a particular concept in Indian ancient Vedic literature,
yes.
And it's called Adbhut Rasa. So Adbhut Rasa stands for how do we have wonderment in life, and wonderment in life, and it goes on to say that there are two ways in which you can have wonderment. One is where it naturally comes, you know, as a stimulus from the environment, and the other is to look for the unobvious within the obvious, and develop wonderment. So it's very interesting.
Yeah, that's fascinating. So it is possible that this skill is one of those most underrated skills in the world, right? So you get any child who says performing poorly in school or anything. Why? Because he hates math. Yeah. So if what Sori says, right, if interest is a skill, then all he has to do is to teach the child to be interested in things. Then he can make math interesting to himself. Then he can be good in math.
Yeah, I think it's very revolutionary, this whole idea, because the popular commentary that we hear is find a thing that interests you and just follow it. You know, that's the way the commentary comes from parents and society. The moment you say that, turn the gaze and make interest itself as a skill, I think the whole game changes. Absolutely.
Yeah.
Amazing. Amazing.
Yeah. Blows my mind as well.
How do you think... you have this wonderful, you've reached a space in your journey in life now, and you have access to a lot of leaders today, leaders from all spectrum, political, business. What would be your next couple of years of intervention with these leaders? Because the quality of leaders shape the quality of community. What do you think would you be doing in the next couple of years to bring about a shift in them? I'm sure you talk to most of them almost on a frequent basis.
I am embarking on an ambitious project, which is crazier than my usual projects.
And there's more. And there's more.
So we begin with like people who gain mastery in deep practice. And I see that they have at least three important skills or realizations, whatever you call it. The first one is shamatha. When calm abiding, for those who don't know the Pali words. So what happens is when you master shamatha, you have ability to bring about extreme joy and extreme calmness on demand. It's a state called jhana or dhyana. So that's one skill you have. The other skill you have is the insight that breaks into no-selfness. Right, you learn to recognize or you see that self is entirely created by mind, and therefore there are moments when mind doesn't create self and you can see those, right? And that changes everything. So that's the second skill. The third skill, I can tell you for sure I definitely don't have, is the ability to love everybody, love anybody, right? And you can see in Matthew Ricard's that wing skin, for example, right? He's, when he think about love and kindness and compassion, his brain goes, right? Yes. And so I look at a chart, I don't understand, I see a line going about, what does this mean? And so one neuroscientist, Richie, we know who that is, Richie Davidson, Richie explained to me, my brother Richie, he says, imagine an elephant charging at you, right? That amount of fear. And imagine on the positive side of it, that amount of joy and love. And imagine being able to bring it out voluntarily in 2 seconds. So Matthew can do that.
Wow.
That's how much love he can have for anybody. Everybody. So imagine that you have three qualities like this. Peace and joy, no selfness or selflessness, and love, compassion.
Amazing.
Imagine having these people in positions of power and leadership. Imagine having prime ministers, presidents, whatever, and captains of industry, CEOs and so on. And so I think there are three problems we need to solve. The first problem is that there are not enough of these people in the world to begin with.
Yes.
The second problem is that not just there's not enough, there's not enough of them in the real world. Right? So a lot of those we know of are in the mountains, in the caves, in the monasteries. They're not in the real world. Second problem. The third problem is that those in the real world are not on like zero. So I don't know. Zero of them are at the level of self-made billionaire or prime minister or president or something. It's high but zero. So these three problems we need to solve. And I'm hoping the next few years I'm going to begin to solve these three problems. So the way to solve these problems, the first is accessibility, right? Making the training understandable and accessible. So there's a forgive me for using a Buddhist word, there's a Pali word, there's a word sotapana or sotapati. Sotapati means entering the stream. Sotapana means the person who enters the stream. And the sotapana has the characteristic I just talked about, those selflessness and love and so on. So we want to make sotapati training accessible to all. So part of it is providing the training ground, part of it is explaining things in scientific, practical ways, part of it is creating the science. So that's one. Yeah. The second thing is scaling. Once we create this this environment, this training, how do we scale it massively? So that by the time I die, there's 1 million sotapanas in the world.
Amazing.
Second problem. And the way I see it is the democratization of enlightenment. Enlightenment of the people, for the people, as embodied by the people, shall not perish from this earth.
Amazing, Meng. Amazing. Yeah. Amazing.
That's number two. And then number three problem, number three is part of the third part of the solution is having trained these people, we facilitate their success in the real world. For example, we invest in their startups. We help them found new nonprofits. We help them get the leadership position and so on. So these three problems that we solve all at once. And so now I have a partial solution. I'm starting really small, we're starting with one, which is we show you about it. Show you is the main person doing this, and just like I'm just talking about it, so I don't do anything. And so what he does is he's a training program that has shown so far to be able to produce sotapanas in 1 to 3 years of intense training.
That's so
first as a program. And then he also, and we're thinking together how to do this. One way is to have one of these things, a monastery, in the same compound as a workplace. So imagine like what's a co-working space, right? So people can pay money to go to rent an office space there. Same building as the monastery. And they come in and out, they talk to each other all the time. Constant interaction. Right? So that's a possible model. With that we can scale. So we can scale because that if a lot of people want to do that, then we have revenue. Then we can scale.
Yes.
But even better than that, what if in addition to the co-working space, we also have a startup incubator, right? And the startup incubator, there are two important advantages. The first advantage is that if the type of people who want to start companies want to do it in their environment with months and months, we already know they'll be successful. I mean, more successful than normal, and we already know they're good hearts.
Yes.
And with the training, with being exposed to these people meditating all the time, when they grow up to become the Googles or Facebook or whatever, they are people with wisdom and compassion. So we have a whole core of companies with wisdom and compassion.
This is revolutionary, man. I think this is revolutionary.
And we're hoping that the monks and nuns, by being exposed to this all the time, by the time they graduate from the program, they become sotapanas. Some large percentage, I'm hoping 90%, will say, I want to do that now. So they'll move over to the other side. So I'm calling the Nirvana side and the Nirvana side. They have to go to the Nirvana side. And then we help them found companies. We invest in them.
This is amazing.
And then they can grow up to become sotapana CEO, sotapana billionaires, and sotapana presidents and prime ministers. So that's my work for the next few years. I think one of my projects, which crazy.
Yeah, and you know, if you allow us, we would love to be part of this in whichever manner you would want us to. This is, I think, this is revolutionary that you're talking about. Absolutely revolutionary.
Thank you. I need to raise money. So we raised 1.3 million. I say we, I mean Australia.
Okay.
We raised 1.3 million for a facility in Vermont.
Okay.
So that's our first test case. So after that, we need to raise 10 million for a facility on the other side, which is California. Right? And then maybe also other places. Then we try scaling. We try to double it every 2 or 3 years. So if you double every 2 years, then you go 4x. In four years and so on. So 2 to the power of 10 is 1024. So in 10 doublings, we can scale by a factor of 1,000.
Wow.
So if we start with 1,000 sotapanas, in 10 doublings, in let's say 20 years, we have 1 million sotapanas.
Amazing. Amazing thing. And I think it also draws in a very intuitive manner, it draws network effect. Because as you scale up, you'll have more and more people trying to be part of it. And I think the second thing that I think I like the example that you gave of having workspaces and meditation spaces or reflection spaces alongside. Because I think if in one of the readings of ancient wisdom, it is said that because man is a forgetful being, you need these signages or placards or idols at separate places so that it keeps reminding you of your, you know, where you are proceeding to. It's a reference point. So it's an interesting thing.
Yeah, correct. So wait, I have an idea for that as well. So remember I said that the Nirvana side, and Nirvana side, and Nirvana being the office space.
Yeah.
So I have this idea that there's always one monk from the Nirvana side on duty in the Nirvana side, and his duty is just to sit there. In the middle of the workspace, where people are working, he just sits there and meditate. Right? And then every 2 hours, somebody rotates, right? So there's always sitting there at all times. So we can actually turn this into a sustainable model for people training, for monastic training. Right? So right now, monks and nuns and monasteries, they need donations. And in the US, for example, it's very hard to get donations to sustain them. So if companies can just, they rent a monk, right? They rent somebody to come and sit in the middle of the workspace for 8 hours a day. And then pay whatever the rent it is. Then you have that, what you say, and then you have the sustainability.
Yes.
So how do you begin that? I think I want to ask you for your help. Begin it by first have a winning company, have a monk, somebody with deep, sincere practice. So not somebody from the street, but somebody dedicating their life to practice, sitting there.
Yes.
Right? And then see if that works. And then through multiple iterations, we find out, we collect data. So for example, we ask the people around the office, the guy sitting there, does it change anything? And they might say, nah, I just waste my time or whatever. Or they might say, wow, I was so angry today, but I see him and I'm no longer angry. And I went to the meeting and so on. Then we can collect, and then we might say, make small changes. So maybe instead of sitting there, he sits in the meeting room. See what changes. So maybe every meeting room has a person sitting and so on. Right? And then through that, we find a model that works for companies, and then we can scale it so that people can practice meditation for a living.
I think it's a very interesting and doable idea. I think it's very interesting, doable, and I think it has its own... I think it could be... I would wish, and I also believe it will be impactful.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. So thanks for trying this.
Thank you so much. And we'll keep reaching out to you for more wisdom and more insights. Thank you so much, Meng.
Thank you, my friend.
Thank you so much. Thank you.